mistress of, and would you yet I were any merrier? Unless you could teach me to forget a banished father, you must not learn me how to remember any extraordinary pleasure. Herein I see thou lovest me not with the full weight that I love thee. If my uncle, thy banished father, had banished thy uncle, the duke, my father, so thou hadst been still with me, I could have taught my love to take thy father for mine. So wouldst thou, the truth of thy love to me, were so righteously tempered as mine is to thee. Well, I will forget the condition of my estate to rejoice in yours.
You know my father hath no child but I. And truly, when he dies, what he hath taken away from thy father perforce, I will render thee again in affection. By mine honor I will, and when I break that oath, let me turn monster.
Therefore, my sweet Rose, my dear Rose, be merry. From henceforth I will, cuz, and devise sport. Let me see. What thinks you of falling in love?
Let us mock the good housewife Fortune, that her gifts may henceforth be bestowed equally.
I would we could do so, for her benefits are mightily misplaced.
Tis true, for though she makes fair, she scarce makes honest, and for though she makes honest, she makes very ill-favoredly.
Nay, now thou goest from Fortune's office to nature's. Fortune reigns in the gifts of the world, not in the lineaments of nature.
No, when nature hath made a fair creature, may she not by Fortune fall into fire? Though nature hath given us wit to flaunt at Fortune, hath not Fortune sent in this fool to cut off the argument? How now, wit, whither wander you?
Mistress, you must come away to your father.
Were you made the messenger?
No, by mine honor, but I was bid to come for you.
Where learned you that oath?
Of a certain knight that swore by his honor, they were good pancakes, and swore by his honor, the mustard was not. Now, I'll stand to it. The pancakes were not, and the mustard was good, and yet was not the knight forsworn.
How prove you that in the great heap of your knowledge?
I marry now, and muzzle your wisdom.
Stand you both forth now, stroke your chins, and swear by your beards that I am a knave.
By our beards, if we had them, then thou art.
By my knavery, if I had it, then I were. But if you swear by that that is not, you are not forsworn. No more was this knight swearing by his honor, for he never had any, or, if he had, he had sworn it away before ever he saw those pancakes or that mustard.
Prithee, who is that thou meanest?
One that old Frederick your father loves.
My father's love is enough to honor him. Enough! Speak no more. You'll be whipped for taxation one of these days.
The more pity that fools may not speak wisely what wise men do foolishly.
By my troth, I say it's true. For since the little wit that fools have, the silence, the little foolery that wise men have makes a great show.
As I remember, Adam, it was upon this fashion bequeathed me by will, but poor 1,000 crowns. And, as thou sayest, charge my brother on his blessing to breed me well. And there begins my sadness. My brother keeps me rustically at home, or, to speak more properly, stays me here at home unkept. His horses are bred better, for besides that they are fair with their feeding, they are taught their manage, and to that end, riders dearly hire. But I, his brother, gain nothing under him but growth. He lets me feed with his hinds, bars me the place of a brother, and, as much as in him lies, minds my gentility with my education. This is it, Adam, that grieves me, and the spirit of my father, which I think is within me, begins to mutiny against this servitude. I will no longer endure it, though yet I know no wise remedy how to avoid it.
Now, sir, what make you here?
Nothing. I have not taught to make anything.
What mar you then, sir?
Harry, sir, I am helping you to mar that which God made. A poor, unworthy brother of yours with idleness.
Marry, sir, be better employed, and be not a while. Know you where you are, sir?
Oh, indeed, sir, here in your orchard.
Know you before whom, sir?
I know you are my eldest brother, and on the gentle condition of blood, you should so know me. The courtesy of nations allows you my better in that you are the firstborn, but that same tradition takes not away my blood were there 20 brothers betwixt us. Ha! I have as much of my father in me as you!
What, boy?
Come, come, elder brother, you are too young in this!
Wilt thou lay hands on me, villain?
I am no villain! I am the youngest son of Sir Roland de Bois. He was my father, and he is thrice a villain that says such a father begot villains.
Sweet masters, be patient for your father's remembrance. Be at accord.
My father charged you in his will to give me good education. You have trained me as a peasant, obscuring and hiding from me all gentlemanlike qualities. The spirit of my father grows strong in me, and I will no longer endure it. Therefore, give me the poor lottery my father left me by testament. With that, I will go buy my fortunes.
And what wilt thou do? Beg when that is spent? Well, sir, get you in. I will no longer be troubled with you. You shall have some part of your will. I pray that you leave me.
I will no further offend you than becomes me for my good.
Get you with it, you old dog.
Is old dog my reward? Most true, I have lost my teeth in your service. God be with my old master. He would not have spoke such a word.
Good morrow to your worship.
Good Monsieur Charles. What's the new news at the new court?
There's no news at the court, sir, but the old news. That is, the old duke is banished by his younger brother, the new duke, and three or four loving lords have put themselves into voluntary exile with him, whose lands and revenues enrich the new duke. Therefore, he gave them good leave to wander.
Can you tell if Rosalind, the old duke's daughter, be banished with her father?
Oh, no. For the duke's daughter, her cousin, so loves her, being ever from their cradles bred together, that she would have followed her exile, or have died to stay behind her. She is at the court, and never two ladies loved as they do.
Where will the old duke live?
They say he is already in the forest of Arden, and a many merry men with him. And there they live like the old Robin Hood of England. They say many young gentlemen flock to him every day and fleet the time carelessly, as they did in the Golden World.
What? You wrestle tomorrow before the new duke.
Ah, marry, do I, sir? And I came to acquaint you with a matter. I'm given, sir, secretly, to understand that your younger brother, Orlando, hath a disposition to come in against me to try a fall. Tomorrow, sir, I wrestle for my credit, and he that escapes me without some broken limb shall acquit him well. Your brother is but young and tender. And for your love, I would be loath to foil him, as I must, for my own honor, if he come in.
Charles, I thank thee for thy love to me, which thou shalt find I most kindly requite. I have myself notice of my brother's purpose herein, and have by underhand means labored to dissuade him from it, but he is resolute. I will tell thee, Charles, it is the stubbornest young fellow of France, full of ambition, an envious emulator of every man's good parts, a secret and villainous contriver against me, his natural brother. Therefore, use thy discretion. I had his leave thou didst break his neck as his finger. And thou wert best to look through it, for I assure thee, and almost with tears I speak it, there is not one so young and so villainous this day living. I speak but brotherly of him. But should I anatomize him to be as he is, I must blush and weep, and thou must look pale and wonder.
I am heartily glad I came hither to you. If he come tomorrow, I'll give him his payment. If ever he go alone again, I'll never wrestle for prize more. And so, God keep your worship.
Farewell, good Charles. Now will I stir this gamester. I shall see an end of him, for my soul, yet I know not why, hates nothing more than he. Yet he's gentle. For schooled and yet learned, full of noble device, of all sorts enchantingly beloved, and especially in the heart of the world, and indeed in my own people who best know him, I am altogether misprized. But it shall not be so long, this wrestler shall clear all. Nothing remains but that I kindle the boy thither, which now I go about.
Bonjour, Madame Mabeau. What's the news?
Oh, fair princess, you have lost much good sport.
Sport? What color?
What color, madam? How shall I answer you?
As wit and fortune will.
Or as the destinies decree.
Well said, that was laid on with a trowel.
Nay, if I keep not my rank.
Thou losest thy old smell.
You amaze me, ladies. I would have told you of good wrestling that you have lost the sight of.
Yet tell us the manner of this wrestling.
I may tell you the beginning, and if it please your ladyships, you may see the end, for the best is yet to do, and here where you are, they are coming to perform it.
Well, the beginning that is said and buried.
An old man and his three sons.
I could match this beginning with an old tale.
Three proper young men of excellent growth and presence.
With bills on their necks, be it known unto all men by these presents.
The eldest of the three wrestled with Charles, the Duke's wrestler, which Charles in a moment threw him and broke three of his ribs, that there is little hope of life left in him. So he served the second, and so the third. Yonder they lie, the poor old man, their father, making such pitiful dole over them that all the beholders take his part with weeping.
Alas!
But what is the sport, madame, that the ladies have lost?
Oh, why, this that I speak of.
Thus men may grow wiser every day. It is the first time that ever I heard breaking of ribs was sport for ladies.
Or I promise thee. Shall we see this wrestling, cousin?
Must you stay here? For here is
Alas, he is too young, yet he looks successfully.
How now, daughter and cousin? Are you crept hither to see the wrestling?
Aye, my liege, so please, you give us leave.
You'll take little delight in it, I can tell you. There is such odds in the man. In pity of the challenger's youth, I would fain dissuade him, but he would not be entreated. Speak to him, lady, see if you can move him.
Come hither, good Madame Lebeau.
Do so, I'll not be by.
Monsieur the challenger, the princess calls for you.
I meet them with all respect and duty.
Young man, have you challenged Charles the wrestler?
No, fair princess. He's the general challenger. I come but in as others do to try with him the strength of my youth.
Young gentlemen! Your spirits are too bold for your years. You have seen cruel proof of this man's strength. We pray you, for your own sake, to embrace your own safety and give over this attempt.
Do, young sir. Your reputation shall therefore not be misprized. We will make it our suit to the Duke that the wrestling might not go forward.
I beseech you, punish me not with your hard thoughts, but let your fair eyes and gentle wishes go with me to my trial, wherein, if I be failed, there is but one shame that was never gracious. If killed, one dead that is willing to be so.
The little strength I have, I would it were with you.
And mine to eke out hers.
Fare you well. Pray heaven I be deceived in you.
Your heart's desires be with you.
Come, where is this young gallant that is so desirous to lie with his mother earth?
Ready, sir. But his will hath been in a more modest working.
You shall try but one fall.
No, I warrant your grace, you shall not entreat him to a second that hath so mightily persuaded him from a first.
Oh. You mean to mock me after. You should not have mocked me before, but come your ways.
Oh! 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 God. Oh.
Name,
Orlando, my liege, the younger son of Sir Roland de Bois.
I would thou hadst been son to some man else. The world esteemed thy father honorable, but I did find him still mine enemy. But fare thee well, thou art a gallant youth. I would thou hadst told me of another father.
Were I my father, cuz, would I do this?
I am more proud to be Sir Roland's son, his youngest son. I would not change that fate to be adopted heir of Frederick.
My father loved Sir Roland as his soul, and all of the world was of my father's mind. Had I before known this young man, his son, I should have given him tears unto entreaties, ere he should thus have ventured.
Gentle cousin, let us thank him and encourage him. My father's rough and envious disposition sticks me at heart. Sir, you have well deserved. If you do keep your promises in love, but justly, as you have exceeded all promise, your mistress shall be happy.
Gentlemen, wear this for me. Hello, cousin?
Hi! Fare you well, fair gentlemen.
Can I not say I thank you? My better parts are all thrown down, and that which here stands is but a quintain, a mere lifeless block.
He calls us back. My pride fell with my fortunes. I'll ask him what he would. Did you call, sir? Sir, you have wrestled well and overthrown more than your enemies.
Will you go, cuz?
Have with you. Fare you well.
What passion hangs these weights upon my tongue? I cannot speak to her, yet she urges conference. Poor Orlando, thou art overthrown.
Good sir, I do in friendship counsel you to leave this place. Albeit you have deserved high commendation, true applause, and love, yet such is now the Duke's condition that he misconstrues all that you have done. The Duke is humorous, but he is indeed more suits you to conceive than I to speak of.
I thank you, ma'am, and pray you tell me this. Which of the two was daughter of the Duke that here was at the wrestle?
Oh, well, neither his daughter, if we judge by manners. But yet, indeed, the smaller is his daughter. The other is daughter to the banished Duke, and here detained by her usurping uncle, to keep his daughter company, whose loves are dearer than the natural bond of sisters. But I can tell you that of late this Duke hath taken displeasure against his gentle niece, and on my life his malice against the lady shall soon break forth. Sir, fare you well. Hereafter, in a better world than this, I shall desire more love and knowledge of you.
I rest much bounden to you. Fare you well. Thus must I, from the smoke into the smother, from a tyrant Duke unto a tyrant brother. Heavenly Rosalind.
Why, cousin? Why, Rosalind, Cupid have mercy, not a word.
Not one to throw at a dog.
Is it possible on such a sudden you should fall into so strong a liking with Sir Roland's youngest son?
The Duke, my father, loved his father dearly.
Doth it therefore ensue that you should love his son as dearly? By this kind of chase, I should hate him, for my father hated his father dearly. Yet I hate not Orlando.
No, Faith, hate him not for my sake.
Why should I not? Doth he not deserve well?
Let me love him for that. And do you love him because I do?
Look, here comes the Duke with his eyes full of anger.
Mistress, dispatch you with your safest haste and get you from our courts.
Me, uncle.
You, cousin, within these 10 days, if that thou be'st found so near a public court as 20 miles, thou diest for it.
I do beseech your grace, let me the knowledge of my fault bear with me. Dear uncle, never so much as in a thought unborn did I offend your highness.
Thus do all traitors. Let it suffice thee, I trust thee not.
Yet your mistrust cannot make me a traitor. Tell me where all my livelihood depends.
Thou art thy father's daughter. There's enough.
So was I when your highness took his dukedom. So was I when your highness banished him. Treason is not inherited, my lord. Or if we did derive it from our friends, what's that to me? My father was no traitor. In good, my liege, mistake me not so much to think my poverty is treacherous.
Dear sovereign, hear me speak.
I steal me, or we stand over your sake. I'll hatch you with her father wrench along.
If she be a traitor, why, so am I. We still have slept together, rose at an instant, learned, played, eat together, and wheresoever we went, like jewel swans, we were coupled and inseparable.
She is so subtle for thee, a
speak to the people and they pity her! Thou art a fool! She robs thee of thy name, and thou wilt show more bright and see more virtuous when she is gone. Then open not thy lips! Firm and irrevocable is my doom which I have passed upon her. She is banished!
Pronounce that sentence then on me, my liege! I cannot live out of her company!
You are a fool! Eunice, provide yourself, if you outstay the time, upon my honor and in the greatness of my word! You die!
Oh, my poor Rosalind, whither wilt thou go? Wilt thou change fathers? I will give thee mine. I charge thee, be not thou more grieved than I am.
I have more cause.
Thou hast not, cousin. Prithee, be cheerful. Knowest not the Duke hath banished me, his daughter?
That he hath not.
No, hath not. Rosalind, then lacks the love that teacheth thee that thou and I art one. Shall we be sundered? Shall we part, sweet girl? No. Let my father seek another heir. Therefore, devise with me how we may fly, whither to go and what to bear with us. And do not seek to take your change upon you, to bear your griefs yourself and leave me out, for by this heaven I'll go along with thee.
Whither shall we go?
To seek mine uncle in the forest of Arden.
Alas, what danger would it be to us, mates, as we are, to travel forth so far? Beauty provoketh thee sooner than gold.
I'll put myself in poor and mean attire with a kind of umber smudge my face. No like do you, so shall we pass along and never stir assailants.
Were it not better, because I am more than common tall, that I did suit myself all points like a man. A gallant curtle axe upon my thigh, a boar spear in my hand, and in my heart lie there with hidden women's spears therewith. We'll have a swashing and martial outside, as many other mannish cowards have, that do outface it with their semblances.
What shall I call thee when thou art a man?
I'll have no worse name than Jove's own page, and therefore you shall call me Ganymede. But what will you be called?
Something that hath a reference to my state, no longer Celia, but Aliena.
But, cousin, what if we essayed to steal the clownish fool out of your father's court? Would he not be a comfort to our travel?
He'll go along over the wide world with me. Leave me alone to woo him. Let's away and get our jewels and our wealth together, devise the fittest time and safest way to hide us from pursuit that will be made after my flight. Now, go and consent to liberty, and not to banishment.
Oh, unhappy youth, come not within these doors.
Why, what's the matter?
Within this roof, the enemy of all your graces lives. Your brother hath heard your praises, and this night he means to burn the lodging where you used to lie, and you within it. I overheard him in his practices. This is no place. His house is but a butchery. Abhor it, fear it, do not enter it.
Why, whither, Adam, wouldst thou have me go?
No matter whither, so you come not here.
What, wouldst thou have me go and beg my food? Or with a base and boisterous sword enforce a thievish living on the common road? I will rather subject me to the malice of a diverted blood and bloody brother.
Oh, but do not so. I have 500 crowns, the 30 hire I saved unto your father, which I did store to be my foster nurse, when service should in my old limbs lie lame, in unregarded aged corners thrown. He that doth the raven feed, take that gate providently caters to the sparrow. Be comfort to my age. Here is the gold. All of this I give to you. Let me be your servant. Though I look old, yet I'm strong and lusty. For in my youth, I never did apply hot and rebellious liquors in my blood, nor did not with unbashful forehead woo the means of weakness and debility. Therefore, my age is as a lusty winter, frosty yet kindly. Let me go with you. I'll do the service of a younger man in all your business and necessities. Oh!
Good old man, how well in thee appears the constant service of the antique world, where duties sweat for service and not for meat. Thou art not for the fashion of these times, where none will sweat but for promotion, and having that do choke their service up even with the having. It is not so with thee. But come thy ways. We'll go along together, and ere we have thy youthful wages spent, we'll light upon some settled low content.
Master, go on, and I shall follow thee to the last grasp of truth and loyalty. From 17 years till now, almost 80, here liveth I, but live here no more.
Can it be possible that no man saw them? It cannot be. Some villains of my court are of consent and sufferance in this.
I cannot hear of any that did see her. The ladies, her attendants of her court, saw her abed, and in the morning early they found their bed untreasured of their mistress. My lord,
the Rhodish clan at whom so oft your grace was wont to laugh, is also missing. Hesperia, the princess's gentlewoman, confesses that she secretly o'erheard your daughter and her cousin much commended the parts and graces of the wrestler that did but lately foil the sinewy Charles, and she believes, wherever they have gone, the youth is surely in their company.
Send to his brother, fetch that gallant hither. If he be absent, bring his brother to me. I'll make him find him. Do this suddenly, and let not search and inquisition quail to bring again these foolish runaways!
To avoid him. He is too disputable for my company. I think of as many matters as he, but I give heaven thanks and make no boast of them. Come, warble, come.
I pray you, bear with me. I cannot go no further.
For my part, I'd rather bear with you than bear you. Yet, I should bear no cross if I did bear you, for I think you have no money in your purse.
This is the forest of Arden.
Aye, now am I in Arden, the more fool I. When I was at home, I was in a better place, but travelers must be content.
Aye, be so, good Touchstone. Look who comes here, a young man and woman in solemn talk.
That is the way to make her scorn you still.
Oh, Corin, that thou knewest how I do love her.
I partly guess, for I have loved ere now.
No, Corin. Being old, thou canst not guess. Though in thy youth thou wast as true a lover as ever sighed upon a midnight pillow. But if thy love were ever like to mine, as sure I think did never man love so, how many actions most ridiculous hast thou been drawn to by thy fantasy?
Into 1,000 that I have forgotten.
Oh, thou didst then never love so heartily. If thou rememberest not the slightest folly that ever love did make thee run into, thou hast not loved. Or if thou hast not sat as I do now, wearying thy hearer in thy mistress's praise, thou hast not loved. Or if thou hast not broke from company abruptly, as my passion now makes me, thou hast not loved. Oh, Phoebe! Phoebe!
Ask poor shepherd, searching of thy wound, I have by hard adventure found mine own.
And I mine. I remember when I was in love, I broke my sword upon a stone and bid him take that for coming a night to Jane Smile. And I remember the kissing of her battler and the cow's dugs that her pretty chopped hands had milked. And I remember the wooing of a peascod instead of her, from whom I took 2 cods, and giving her them again, said with weeping tears, wear these for my sake. We that are true lovers run into strange capers, but as all is mortal in nature, so is all nature in love mortal in folly.
Thou speakest wiser than thou art aware of.
Nay, I shall never be aware of mine own wit till I break my shins against it.
Jove, Jove, this shepherd's passion, it's much upon thy fashion.
And mine, but it grows something stale with me.
I pray you, one of you questioned if young woman will give us any food for gold. I faint almost to death.
Hola, you clown!
Peace! My kinsman!
Who called?
Your betters, madam.
Oh, very wretched.
Peace, I say! Good evening, friend.
And to you, gentle sir, and to you all.
I prithee, if that love or gold can in this desert place buy entertainment, bring us where we may rest ourselves and feed. Here is a young maid with travel much oppressed. Thanks for supper.
Fair sir, I pity her, and wish for her sake more than for my own. My fortunes were more able to relieve her, but I am shepherd to another man, and do not shear the fleece I graze. My master is of churlish disposition, and little Rex finds a way to heaven by doing deeds of hospitality. Besides, his coat, his flocks, and bounds of feed are on sale and at our sheepcote now. In reason of his absence, there is nothing for you to feed on, but what is comfy and by my voice most welcome shall you be.
What is he that shall buy his flock and pasture?
That young swain you saw but erewhile, who little cares for buying anything.
I pray you, if it stand with honesty, buy thou the cottage, the pasture, and the flock, and thou shalt have to pay for it of us.
And we will mend thy wages. I like this place and could willingly waste my time in it.
Assuredly, the things to be sold. Go with me, if you like, upon report, the soil, the profit in this kind of life, I will your most faithful feeder be and buy it with your gold right suddenly.
Dear master, I can go no further. Oh, I die for food. Here lie I down and measure out my grave. Farewell, kind master.
Why, how now, Adam, no greater heart in thee? Live a little, comfort a little, cheer thyself a little. If this uncouth forest yield anything savage, I will either be food for it or bring it for food to thee. For my sake, be comfortable. Hold death a while at the arm's end. I will be here with thee presently, and if I give thee nothing to eat, I shall give thee leave to die. But if thou diest before I come, thou art a mocker of my labor. Come, I will bear thee to some shelter, and thou shalt not die for lack of a dinner filled with anything in this desert. Cheer thee, good Adam.
Now, my co-mates and brothers in exile,
Have not old custom made this life more sweet than that of painted pomp? Are not these woods more free from adversity than the pompous court? Sweet are the uses of adversity, which, like the toad, ugly and venomous, wears yet a precious jewel in his hand. And this, our life, exempt from public haunts, finds tongues in trees, books in the running brooks, sermons in stones, and good in everything.
Oh, I would not change it. Happy is your grace that can translate the stubbornness of fortune into so quiet and so sweet a style.
Come, shall we go and kill us venison?
And yes, it irks me, the poor dappled fools, being native burghers of this desert city, should in their own confines with forked heads have their round paunches gored.
Indeed, my lord, the melancholy Jaques grieves at that, and in that kind swears you do more usurp than doth your brother that hath banished you. Today, my lord of Amiens and myself did steal behind him as he lay along under an oak whose antique root peeps out upon the brook that brawls along this wood. To the witch place, a poor sequestered stag that from the hunter's aim hath taken a hurt did come to languish. And indeed, my lord, the wretched animal heaved forth such groans that their discharge did stretch his leathern coat almost to bursting, and the big round tears coursed one another down his innocent nose in piteous chase. And thus, the hairy fool, much marked of the melancholy Jaques, stood on the extremest verge of the swift brook, augmenting it with tears.
But what said Jaques? Did he not moralize this spectacle?
Oh, yes, into a thousand similes. Thus, most invectively, he pierced it through the body of country, city, court, yea, and of this our life, swearing that we are mere usurpers, tyrants, and what's worse, to fright the animals and to kill them up in their assigned and native dwelling place.
And did you leave him in this contemplation?
Oh, we did, my lord, weeping and commenting upon the sobbing deer.
Show me the place. I love to cope him in these solemn fits. It is full of matter.
I'll bring you to him straight. He saved my labor by his own approach.
Why, how now, monsieur? What life is this that your poor friends must woo your company? What? You look merrily.
A fool. A fool. I met a fool in the forest. A motley fool. A miserable world. As I do live by food, I met a fool who laid him down and basked him in the sun, and railed on Lady Fortune in good terms, in good set terms, and yet a motley fool. Good morrow, fool, quoth I. No, sir, quoth he, call me not fool till heaven have sent me fortune. And then he drew a dial from his poke, and looking on it with lackluster eye, says very wisely, it is 10 o'clock, thus we may see, quoth he, how the world wags. 'Tis but an hour ago since it was 9, and after 1 hour more, 'twill be 11. And so from hour to hour we ripe, and then from hour to hour we rot, and thereby hangs a tale. As I did hear the motley fool thus moral on the time, my lungs began to groan like chanticleer, that fools could be so deep contemplative.
And what fool is this?
Oh, worthy fool, one that have been a courtier, and says, if ladies be but young and fair, they have the gift to know it. And in his brain, which is as dry as remainder biscuit after a long voyage, he have strange places crammed with observation, but which events and mangled forms, oh, that I were a fool. I am ambitious for a motley coat.
Thou shalt have one.
It is my only suit. Give me liberty withal as large a charter as the wind to blow on whom I please, for so fools have. And they that are most galled in my folly, they most must laugh. Give me leave to speak my mind, and I will through and through cleanse the foul body of the infected world, if they will receive my medicine.
Fie on thee, I can tell you what thou wouldst do.
What would I do with good?
Most mischievous foul sin and chiding sin, for thou thyself hast been a libertine, as sensual as the brutish sting itself. and all the embossed sores and headed evils that thou with license of Freeport Ascot wouldst thou disgorge into the general world.
Forbear ye no more!
What,
nor shalt not till necessity be served.
Of what kind should this cock come up?
Art thou thus bolded, man, by thy distress, or else a rude despiser of good manners, and in civility thou seem so empty?
You touched my vein at first. The thorny point of bare distress hath taken from me this show of smooth civility. Yet am I inland bred, and know some nurture. But forbear, I say, he dies that touches any of this fruit till I and my affairs are answered.
And you will not be answered with reason I must die?
What would you have? Your gentleness shall force us more than your force move us to gentleness.
I almost die for food, and let me have it.
Sit down and feed, and welcome to our table.
Speak you so gently? Pardon me, I pray you, I thought that all things had been savage here, and therefore put I on the countenance of stern commandment. But whatever you are, that in this desert inaccessible under the shade of melancholy boughs, lose and neglect the creeping hours of time. If ever you have looked on better days, if ever have been where bells have knolled to church, if ever sat at any good man's feast, if ever from your eyelids wiped a tear and know what is to pity and be pitied, let gentleness my strong enforcement be, in the which hope I blush and hide my sword.
True is it that we have seen better days, and therefore sit you down in gentleness, and take upon command what help we have, that to your wanting may be ministered.
Then but forbear your food a while, whilst I, like a doe, go to find my fawn and give it food. There is an old, poor man whom after me hath many a weary step limped in pure love. Till he be first suffice, oppressed with two weak evils, age and hunger, I will not touch a bit.
Go find him out, and we will nothing waste till you return.
I thank you, and be blessed for your good comfort.
Thou seest we are not all alone unhappy. This wide and universal theater presents more woeful pageants than the scene wherein we play.
All the world's a stage. And all the men.
And women.
Merely players. And they have their exits and their entrances. And one man in his time plays many parts, his acts being seven ages. First, the infant, mewling and puking in the nurse's arms. Then the whining schoolboy, with his satchel and shiny morning face, creeping like snail unwillingly to school. And then the mother, sighing like furnace, with a woeful ballad made to his mistress' eyebrow. Then, a soldier full of strange oaths and bearded like the pard, jealous in honor, sudden and quick in quarrel, seeking the bubble reputation even in the cannon's mouth. And then the justice, in fair round belly with good cape on line, with eyes severe and beard of formal cuts, full of wise saws and modern instances. And so he plays his part. The sixth age shifts into the lean and slippered pantaloon, with spectacles on nose and pouch on side, his youthful hose well saved, a world too wide for his shrunk shank, and his big, manly voice turning again to a childish treble, pipes and whistles in his sound. Last scene of all, that ends this strange, eventful youthful history. Is second childishness and mere oblivion. Sans teeth, sans eyes, sans taste, sans everything.
Welcome. Sit down, your venerable girl, and let him be.
I thank you most, Orban.
So how do you need? I scarce can speak to thank you for myself.
Welcome, all two. I will not trouble you as yet to question about your fortune. Give us some music, and good cousin, sing. Support him by the arm. Give me your hand, and let me all your fortunes understand.
Not seen him since!
Sir, sir, it cannot be. But were I not the better part made mercy, I should not seek an an argument of my revenge! Thou present! But look to it. Find out thy brother, wheresoever he is. Seek him with candle. Bring him dead, or living within this solemn, or turn that whore to seek a living in our territory. Thy lands, and all things that thou dost call thine, do we seize into our hands, till thou canst quit thee by thy brother's mouth?
hang there my verse in witness of my love. And thou, thrice crowned queen of night, survey with thy chaste eye from thy pale spear above thy huntress name that my whole life doth sway. Oh, Rosalind, these trees shall be my books, and in their barks my thoughts of character, that every eye which in this forest looks might see your virtues witnessed everywhere. Run, run, Orlando, carve on every tree the fair, the chaste, and unexpressive sheep.
And how like you to shepherd's life, Master Tetra?
Truly, shepherd, in respect of itself, it is a good life, but in respect that it is a shepherd's life, it is not. In respect it is solitary, I like it very well, but in respect it is private, it is a very vile life. Now, in respect it is in the fields, it pleaseth me well, but in respect it is not in the courts, it is tedious. Ask any philosophy in thee, shepherd.
No more, but that I know that the worse one sickens, the worse he is, that he that wants money needs content without three good friends, that the property of rain is to wet and fire to burn, that a good pasture makes fat sheep, and a great cause of the night is lack of the sun.
Such a one is a natural philosopher.
Teaching all that we need to know, the quintessence of every sprite, heaven, wood,
honorable retreat, though not with bag and baggage, yet with scrimmage and scrimmage.
Didst thou hear these verses?
Oh, yes, I heard them all. And more too. For some of them have ended in more feast than the verses bear.
That's no matter, the feet might bear the verses. Aye, the feet were lame and could not bear themselves without the verse, and therefore stood lamely in the verse.
But didst thou hear without wondering how thy name should be hanged and carved upon these trees?
And you seven out of the 9 days of wonder before you came. For look here, what I found on the palm tree.
Show you what thou is
it a man? And a chain that you once wore about his neck.
Change color.
I prithee who?
Is it possible?
Nay, with most petitionary vehemence, tell me what it is.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful,
and most wonderful, wonderful,
and yet again wonderful, and after that, I'm open.
Dost thou think I am comparisoned like a man? I have a doublet and hose in my disposition. I prithee, tell me what it is quickly, and speak apace. I would thou put a stammer that thou mightst pour this concealed man out of thy mouth as wine comes out of a narrow-mouthed bottle, either too much at once or none at all. I prithee, tell me who it is quickly.
So you make a man
of your belly. Speak me. What manner of a man is? Is that with a hat or a chin with a beard?
Nay, he hath but a little beard.
Oh, God will send more if a man be thankful. Let me stay the growth of his beard if thou delay me not the knowledge of his chin.
It is the young Orlando that tripped up the wrestler's heels and your heart both in an instant.
Nay, but the devil take mocking. Speak sad brow and true, maid.
A fate cursed is he.
Orlando?
Orlando!
Today, what should I do with my doublet and hose? What did he when thou saw him? What said he? How looked he? Where went he? What makes he here?
Did he ask for me?
How parted he with thee, and when shalt thou see him again? Answer me in one word!
Thou must borrow me Gargantua's mouth first.
Says other words?
Too great for any mouth of this age size. To answer I am no to these particulars is more than to answer the catechism.
But doth he know that I am in the forest, and in man's apparel? Looks as freshly as he did the day he wrestled.
It is as easy to count atomies as to resolve the propositions of a lover, but take a taste of my finding him in Russia with good appearance.
I found him under a tree like a dropped acorn.
Give me audience, good madam. There he lay stretched along like a wounded knight.
Such a sight,
it well becomes the ground. Cry hola to thy tongue, I prithee, it curveth unseasonable.
He was furnished by the hunter.
Oh, Amen, is he comes to kill my lord?
Why don't you sing my song without burden? Thou burst me out of tune.
Did you not know I am a woman, but I think I must speak? Sweet, stay on.
You bring me out. Soft, comes he not here?
Tis he, sleep I in the pool.
I thank you for your company, but good faith, I have leave as it did myself.
And so had I, but yet for fashion's sake, I thank you too for your society.
God be with you. Let's meet as little as we can.
I do desire we might be better strangers.
I pray you mar no more trees with writing love songs in their books.
I pray you mar no more of my verses by reading them ill-favoredly.
Rosalind is your love's name?
Yes.
Just. I did not like the name.
There was no thought of pleasing you when she was christened.
What stature is she of?
Just as high as my heart.
You are full of pretty answers. Have you not been acquainted with goldsmiths' wives and combat rings?
Not so, but I answer you right painted cloth from whence you studied your questions.
You have an inner wit. Will you sit down with me, and we too will rail against our mistress, the world, and all our misery?
I will chide no breather in the world but myself, against whom I know most faults.
The worst fault you have is to be in love.
It is a fault I wouldn't change for your best virtue. I'm weary of you.
By my troth, I was seeking for a fool, and I found you.
He's drowned in the brook. Look but in, and you shall see him.
There I shall see my own figure.
Which I take to be either a fool or a cipher.
I'll stand no longer with you. Farewell, good Signor Love.
I'm glad of your departure. Adieu, good Monsieur Melancholy.
I'll speak to him like a saucy lackey, and under that habit, play the neighbor.
Very well, all of you.
I pray you, what is the clock?
You should ask me the time of day. There's no clock in the forest.
Then there is no true lover in the forest, else sighing every minute and groaning every hour would detect the lazy foot of time as well as the clock.
And why not the swift foot of time, had not that been its problem?
By no means, sir. Time travels in diverse cases with diverse persons. I'll tell you who time ambles withal, who time trots withal, who time gallops withal, and who he stands still
withal. Who doth he trot withal?
Mary. He trots hard with the young maid between the contract of her marriage and the day of Solomon. If the interim be but a sennight, then time's pace seems so hard that it seems the length of 7 years.
Who ambles time withal?
The priest that lacks his Latin, and a rich man that hath not the gout. For one sleeps easily because he cannot study, and the other lives merrily because he feels no pain.
Who doth him gallop withal?
With a thief to the gallows. For though he goes as softly as foot can fall, he thinks himself too soon in.
Who stays he still withal?
With lawyers in their vacation, for they sleep between term and term, and then they perceive not how time moves.
Where dwell you, pretty youth?
With the shepherdess, my sister, in the skirts of the forest like fringe upon a petticoat.
Are you native of this place?
As the comb that you see dwell where she is handled.
Your accent is something finer than one can purchase in so removed a dwelling.
I am told so of many, but indeed an old religious uncle of mine taught me to speak, who was in his youth an inland man. One who knew courtship too well, for there he fell in love. I have heard him read many lectures against it, and I think, God, I am not a woman. So many giddy offenses as he generally taxed their whole sex.
Can you remember any of the principal evils that he laid to the charge of women?
There are none principal. They were all as one another as half-pence are. Every one fault seeming monstrous till his fellow fault came to match.
I pray they recount some of them.
No, I will not cast away my physic, but on those that are sick. There is a young man. Haunts the forest that abuses our young plants, carving Rosalind. Hangs oaths upon hawthorns, elegies on brambles, all forsooth deifying the name of Rosalind. If I could be that fancy monger, I would come to good counsel. He seems to have the quotidian of love.
I am he that is so love-shaped. I pray you tell me your remedy.
There are none of my uncle's marks upon you. He taught me how to know a man in love.
What were his marks?
A lean cheek, which you have not. A blue eye and sunken, which you have not. An unquestionable spirit, which you have not. A beard neglected, which you have not. Then your hose should be ungarnered, your bonnet unbanded, your sleeve unbuttoned, your shoe untied, and everything about you demonstrating a careless desolation. But you are no such man. You are rather point device in your accoutrements as loving yourself than seeming the lover of any other.
Fair youth, I would make thee believe I love.
Me believe it? You may as soon make her that you love believe it, which I warrant she is apter to do than confess she is.
This is one of those points in which women still give lie to their consciences.
But, in good sooth, are you he that hangs the verses upon the trees wherein Rosalind is so admired?
I swear to thee, by the white hand of Rosalind, I am that he. How unfortunate he.
But are you so in love as your rhymes speak?
Neither rhyme nor reason can express how much.
Love is merely a madness and deserves as well a dark house and a whip as madmen do. And the only reason why they are not so punished and cured is that the lunacy is so ordinary that the whippers are in love too. Yet I confess curing it by counsel.
Did you ever cure yourself?
Yes, one. And in this manner, he was to imagine me, his love, his mistress. And I set him every day to woo, at which would I, being but a lunacy, would grieve, be effeminate, changeable, longing, liking, proud, fantastical, apish, full of tears, full of smiles, for every passion something, and for no passion truly anything, as boys and women are for the most part cattle of this time. I would now like him, now loathe him, then entertain him, then forswear him, then weep for him, then spit it on, but I drained my suitor from a mad humor of love to a living humor of madness, which was to forswear the full stream of the world to live in a nook merely monastic. And thus, I cure him. I shall take it upon myself to clean your liver as clear as a sound sheep's heart, that there shall not be one spot of love in it.
I would not be cured.
I would cure you!
If you would but call me Rosalind and come every day to my coat and wound.
Now, by the faith of my love, I will. Tell me where it is.
Go with me to it, and I'll show it to you. And by the way, you shall tell me where in the forest you live. Will you go?
With all my heart, Gugu.
Nay, you must call me Rosalind. Come, sister. Will you go?
Come apace, good Audrey. I will fetch up your goats, Audrey. And how, Audrey, am I the man yet? Doth my simple feature content you?
Your features, Lord Warrant us. What features?
I am here with thee and thy goats, as the most capricious poet, honest Ovid, was among the goats. When a man's verses cannot be understood, nor a man's good wit seconded with the forward child understanding, it strikes a man more dead than a great reckoning in the little room. Truly, I would the gods have made thee poetical.
I do not know what poetical is. Is it honest indeed in word? Is it a true thing?
No, truly. For the truest poetry is the most feigning, and lovers are given to poetry. And what they swear in poetry may be said as lovers, they do feign.
Do you wish then that the gods had made me poetical?
I do, truly. For thou swearest to me thou art honest. Now, if thou wert a poet, I might have some hope thou didst feign.
Would you not have me honest?
No, truly. Unless thou wert hard favored. For honesty coupled to beauty is to have honey a sauce to sugar.
Well, I am not fair, and therefore I pray the gods make me honest.
Truly. And to cast away honesty upon a foul slut were to put good meat into an unclean dish.
I am not a slut, though I thank the gods I am foul.
Well, praise be the gods for thy foulness. Sluttishness may come hereafter. Be it as it may be, I will marry thee. And to that end, I have been with Lady Olive Martex, the vicar of the next village, who hath promised to meet me in this place of the forest and to couple us.
Well, the gods give us joy.
Amen. Here comes Lady Olive. Lady Olive Martex, you are well met. Will you dispatch us here under this tree, or shall we go with you to your chapel?
Is there none here to give the woman?
I will not take her on gift of any man.
But truly, she must be given, and the marriage is not lawful.
Proceed, proceed. I'll give her.
Good even, good monsieur, what you call it. How do you do? Very well met. God ill you for your last company. I am very glad to see you, even a toy in hand here, sir. Nay, pray be covered.
Will you be married, Molly?
As the ox hath his bow, sir, the horse his curb, and the falcon her bells, so man hath his desires, and his pigeon's bill, so wedlock would be nibbling.
And will you, being a man, your breeding, be married under a bush like a beggar? Get you to church, and have a good priest that can show you what marriage is. This woman will but join you together as they join wainscots. Then, one of you will prove to be a shrunk panel, and like green timber, warp.
I am not in the mind, but I were better to be married of her than of another, for she is not like to marry me well. And not being well married, it will be a good excuse for me hereafter to leave my wife.
Go thou with me, and let me counsel thee.
Come, sweet Audrey. We must be married, or we must live in Baudry.
Never talk to me. I will weep.
Do, I prithee, yet have the grace to consider that tears do not become a man.
Have I not cause to weep?
As good to cause as one would desire.
Therefore weep.
His hair is of the very dissembling color. Something browner than Judas's. Marry,
sister Judas's own children.
Faith, his hair is of a good color.
An excellent color. Your chestnut was ever the only color.
But why did he swear he would come this morning, and he comes not?
Nay, certainly.
There's no truth in him.
Do you think so?
Yes, I think he's not a pig purse nor a horse stealer, but for his verity and love, I do think him as concave as a covered goblet or a worm-eaten nut.
Not true in love.
Yes, when he is in, but I do not think he is in.
You heard him swear downright he was.
Was is not is. Besides, the oath of a lover is no stronger than that of a tapster. Both are the confirmer of false reckonings. He tents here in the forest on the Duke, your father.
I met the Duke yesterday and had much question. He asked me of what parentage I was, so I told him of as good as he. So he laughed and let me go.
But what talk we of fathers when there is such a man as Orlando?
Oh, there's a brave man. He writes brave verses, speaks brave words, swears brave oaths, and breaks them bravely. What traverse athwart the heart of his lover, but all's brave that youth mounts and folly guides.
Mistress and master, you have oft inquired after the shepherd that complained of love, who you saw sitting by me on the turf, praising the proud and disdainful shepherdess that was his mistress.
And what of him?
If you will see a pageant truly played between the pale complexion of true love and the red glow of scorn and proud disdain, go hence a little and I shall conduct you, if you will mark it.
Come, let us remove. The sight of lovers feedeth those in love. Bring us to this sight, and you shall say I'll prove a busy actor in their play.
Sweet Phoebe, do not scorn me, do not, Phoebe. Say that you love me not, but say not so in bitterness. The common executioner, whose heart the accustomed sight of death makes hard, falls not the axe upon the humbled neck, but first begs pardon. Will you sterner be than he that dies and lives by bloody drops?
I would not be thy executioner. I fly thee, for I would not injure thee.
Thou tellest me there is murder in mine eye. 'Tis pretty, sure, and very probable that eyes, that are the frailest and softest things, who shut their coward gates on atomies, should be called tyrants, butchers, murderers. Now, I do frown on thee with all my heart. And if mine eyes could wound, now let them kill thee. Now show me the wound mine eye hath made in thee. Scratch thee but with a pin, and there remains some scar of it. But mine eyes, which I have darted at thee, hurt thee not, nor I am sure there is any force in eyes that can do hurt.
Oh, dear Phoebe, if ever, as that ever may be near, you meet in some fresh cheek the power of fancy, then will you know the wounds invisible that love's keen arrows make.
But till that time, come not thou near me. And when that time comes, afflict me with thy mocks, pity me not. As till that time, I shall not pity thee.
And why, I pray you, who might be your mother that you insult, exult, and all at once over the wretched? What, though you hath no beauty, as by my faith I see no more in you than without a candle may go dark to bed, must you therefore be proud and pitiless? Why, what means this? Why do you look on me? I think she means to tangle with my eyes, too.
You foolish shepherd, wherefore do you follow her like foggy south puffing with wind and rain? You are a thousand times a properer man than she a woman. 'Tis fools such as you that makes the world full of ill-favored children. 'Tis not her glass, but you that flatters her. And out of you she sees herself more proper than any of her lineaments can show her. But, good mistress, know yourself. Down on your knees and thank heaven fasting for a good man's love.
For I must tell you friendly in your ear.
Sell when you can! You are not for all markets.
Crispin, you, I pray you tie here together. I had rather hear you tie than this man woo.
He's fallen in love with your foulness, and she'll fall in love with my anger.
If it be so, as fast as she answers thee with frowning looks, I'll sauce her with bitter words. Why you look so upon me?
For no ill will I bear you. I pray you, do not fall in love with me, for I am falser than vows made in wine. Besides, I like you not. If you know my house, 'tis at the Tuft of Olives here hard by. Shepherd, ply her hard. Come, sister. Shepherdess, look on him better, and be not proud. Though all the world could see, none could be so abused inside as he.
Dead shepherd, now I finally saw of might. Whoever loved that loved not at first sight?
Sweet Phoebe.
Huh? What sayest thou, Silvius?
Sweet Phoebe, pity me.
Why, I am sorry for thee, gentle Silvius.
Wherever sorrow is, relief would be. If you do sorrow at my grief and love, by giving love your sorrow and my grief, we're both exterminated.
Thou hast my love. Is not that neighborly?
I would have you.
Why, that were covetousness. Silvius, the time was that I hated thee. And yet, it is not that I bear thee love. But since that thou canst talk of love so well, thy company, which erst was irksome to me, I will endure and I'll employ thee too. But do not look for further recompense in thine own gladness if thou art employed. Knowest thou the youth that spoke to me erewhile?
Not very well, but I have met him oft, and he hath bought the cottage and the bounds that the old carlin once was master of.
Think not that I love him, though I ask for him. Tis but a peevish boy. Yet he talks well, but what care I for words? Yet words do well when he that speaks them pleases those that hear. Tis a pretty youth. Not very pretty. Sure, he's proud. And yet his pride becomes him. He'll make a proper man. The best thing in him was his complexion. The faster than his tongue did make offense, his eye did heal it up. He's not very tall. Yet, for his years, he is tall. His leg is but so-so. And yet 'tis well. There's a pretty redness in his lip, a little riper and more lusty red than that mixed in his cheek. 'Twas just the difference betwixt the constant red and the mingled damask. There be some women, Silvius, had they marked him in parcels as I did, would have gone near to fall in love with him. But for my part, I hate him not, nor love him not. And yet I have more cause to hate him than to love him. For what had he to do to chide me? He said my eyes were black and my hair black. And now I'm remembered, scorned at me. I marvel why I answered not again. But that's all one. Omittance is no quittance. I'll write him a very haunting letter, and thou shalt bear it, wilt thou, Silvius?
Phoebe, with all my heart.
I'll write it straight. The matter's in my head, and in my heart. I will be bitter with him, and passing short. Go with me, Silvius!
I prithee, pretty youth, let me be better acquainted with thee.
They say you are a melancholy folk.
I am so. I do love it more than laughing.
Those that are in extremity of either are abominable fellows and betray themselves to every modern censure worse than drunkards.
Why, 'tis good to be sad and say nothing.
Why, then 'tis good to be a post.
I am neither the scholar's melancholy, which is emulation, nor the musician's, which is fantastical, nor the courtier's, which is proud, nor the soldier's, which is ambitious, nor the lawyer's, which is ambitious, nor the lover's, which is nice, nor the lady's, which is all of these. Rather, it is a melancholy all mine own, counted many simples, extracted many objects, and indeed the sundry contemplation of my travels, in which my often rumination wraps me in the most humorous sadness.
A traveler, by my faith, you have great reason to be sad. I fear you have sold your lands to see other men's. To have seen much and to have nothing is to have rich eyes and poor hands.
Yes, I have gained my experience.
And your experience makes you sad. I'd rather have a fool to make me merry than experience to make me sad. And travel for it, too.
Good day and happiness, dear Rosalind.
Nay, then. God be with you, and you talk in blank verse.
Farewell, Mr. Travel. Why, how now, Orlando? Where have you been all this while? You a lover, and you serve me such another trick. Never come in my sight more.
Fair Rosalind, I come within an hour of my promise.
Break an hour's promise in love?
Pardon me, dear Rosalind.
Nay, and you be so tardy. Come no more in my sight. I had as lief be wooed of a snail.
Of a snail?
Aye, of a snail. For though he comes slowly, he carries his house on his head. A better jointure, I think, than you make a woman. Besides, he brings his destiny with him.
What's that?
Why, horns, which such as fain are you to be beholding to your wives for. But he comes armed in his destiny, and prevents the slander of his wife.
Virtue is no horn maker, and my Rosalind is virtuous.
And I am your Rosalind.
It pleases him to call you so, but he hath a Rosalind of a better leer than you.
Come, woo me, for now I am in holiday humor and like enough to consent. What would you say to me now, and I were your very, very Rosalind?
I would kiss before I spoke.
Nay, you better speak first, and when graveled for lack of matters, take occasion to kiss. Very good orders when they are out, ill spit. And for lovers lacking, God warns, matter, the cleanliest shift is to kiss.
How if the kiss be denied?
Then she puts you to entreaty, and there begins a new matter.
Who could be out being before his beloved mistress?
Mary, that should you if I were your mistress, or I should think my honesty ranker than my wit.
What, of my suit?
Not out of your apparel, and yet out of your suit. Am I not sure, Rosalind?
I take to some joy to say you are, because I would be talking of her.
Well, in her person, I say, I will not have.
Then in mine own person, I die.
No, Faith! Die by attorney! The poor world is almost 6,000 years old, and in all that time, never has any man died in his own person in a love cause. Men have died from time to time, and worms have eaten them, but not for love.
I would not have my right Rosalind of this mind, for I protest her frown might kill me.
By this hand, it will not kill a fly. But come, I will now be your Rosalind in a more coming on disposition. Ask me what you will, and I will grant it.
Then love me, Rosalind.
Yes, Faith, will I, Fridays, Saturdays, and all.
And wilt thou have me?
I and 20 such.
What sayest thou?
Are you not good?
I hope so.
Oh, then can one desire too much of a good thing? Come, sister, you shall be priest and marry us. Give me your hand. What do you say, sister?
Pray thee, marry us.
I cannot say the word.
You must begin. Will you, Orlando?
Will you?
Will you, Orlando, have to wife this Rosalind?
I will.
Aye, but when?
Why, now, as fast as she can marry us.
Then you must say, I take thee, Rosalind, for wife.
I take thee, Rosalind, for wife.
I might ask you for your commission, but I do take thee, Orlando, for husband. A girl goes before the priest, and certainly a woman's thoughts run before her actions.
So do all thoughts. They're winged.
Now tell me how long you would have her after you possessed her.
Forever and a day.
Say a day without the ever. No, no, Orlando, men are April when they woo, December when they wed. Maids are May when they are maids, but the sky changes when they are wives. I will be more jealous of thee than a Barbary cockpigeon over his hen, more clamorous than a parrot against the rain, more newfangled than an ape, more giddy in my desires than a monkey. I will weep for nothing like Diana in the fountain, and I shall do that when thou art disposed to be merry. I shall laugh like a hyena that when thou art inclined to sleep.
But will my Rosalind do so?
By my life, she will do as I do!
She is wise.
Or else she would not have the wit to do this.
A man had a wife with such a wit. He might say, wit, whither wilt?
Nay. After check, till you've met your wife's wit, going to your neighbor's bed.
And what wit could wit have to excuse that?
Mary, to say she came to seek you there. You shall never take her without her answer, unless you take her without her tongue. Oh, that woman that could not make her own fault her husband's occasion. Let her never nurse her child herself, for she will breed it like a fool.
For these 2 hours, Rosalind, I will leave thee.
Alas, dear love, I cannot lack the 2 hours.
I must attend the Duke at dinner. By 2 o'clock, I'll be with you again.
Go your ways, go your ways. I knew what you would prove. My friends told me as much, and I thought no less. That flattering tongue of yours won me. 'Tis but one cast away, and so come death. 2 o'clock is your hour?
Aye, sweet Rosalind.
By my troth, if you break one jot of your promise, or come 1 minute behind your hour, I will think you the most pathetical, break promise, and the most hollow lover, and the most unworthy of her that you call Rosalind that can be chosen out of the gross band of the unfaithful. Therefore, beware my censure, and keep your promise.
With no less religion than if thou wert indeed my Rosalind. So, adieu.
Well, time is the old justice that examines all such offenders. And let time try. Adieu.
You have simply misused our sex in your love rape. We must have your doublet and hose plucked over your head and show the world what the bird hath done to her own nest.
Oh, cuz, my pretty little cuz. Does that know how many fathom deep I am in love? But it cannot be sounded. My affection hath an unknown bottom, like the Bay of Portugal.
Or rather bottomless, that as soon as you pour affection in, it runs out.
No, that same wicked bastard Venus, let him judge how deep I am in love. I tell thee, Aliena, I cannot be out of sight of Orlando. I'll go and find the shadow and sigh till he come.
And I'll sleep.
Set the deer's horns upon her head as a branch of victory. Have you no song, Forrester, for this occasion?
Oh, yes, sir.
Sing it. Tis no matter how it be in tune, so it be noise enough.
What shall we have that killed the deer?
I warned you, with pure love and troubled brain, he had taken his bow and arrow and gone forth to sleep.
My errand is to you, fair youth. My gentle Phoebe did bid me give you this. I know not the contents, but as I guess by the stern brow and waspish action which she did use as she was writing of it, it bears an angry tenor. Pardon me, I am but as a guiltless messenger.
She says I am not fair, and that I lack manners. She calls me proud, and that she could not love me were men as rare as Phoenix. Odds my will, her love is not the hair I do hunt. Why writes she so to me? Well, shepherd, well, this is a letter of your own device.
No, I protest I know not the contents. Phoebe did write it.
Come, come, you are a fool, and turned into the extremity of love. I saw her hand. She has a leathered hand, a freestone colored hand. I verily did think her old gloves were on, but 'twas her hand. I say, she did not invent this letter. This is a man's invention and his hand.
Sure, it is hers.
'Tis a boisterous and cruel style, the style for challengers. Will you hear the letter?
So please you, for I never heard it yet. yet heard too much of Phoebe's cruelty.
She Phoebe's me. Mark how the tyrant writes. Art thou God to shepherd turned, that a maiden's heart hath burned?
Can a woman rail thus?
Call you this railing?
Of the scorn of your bright eye, have power to raise such love in mine. Alack in me, what strange effect would they work in mild aspect? Whilst you chide me, I did love. How then might your prayers move? He that brings their love to thee, little known this love in me, and by him seal up thy mind, whether that thy youth and kind will the beautiful offer take of me and all that I can make, or else by him my love deny, and then I'll study how to die.
Call you this chiding?
Alas, poor shepherd. Do you pity him? No, he deserves no pity. Wilt thou love such a woman? Well, shepherd, well, I see love hath made thee a tame snake. Go your way to her, and tell her this, that if she loves me, I charge her to love thee. If she will not, I shall not have her unless thou entreat for her.
Oh, good morrow, fair ones. Pray you if you know where in the purlieus of this forest stands a sheepcote fenced about with olive trees?
Down in the neighbor bottom.
Left on your right hand brings you to the place, but at this hour the house doth keep itself, there's none within.
If that an eye may profit by a tongue, then should I know you by description? The boy's fair, of female favor, and bestows himself like a ripe sister. The woman, low, and browner than her brother. Are not you the owner of the house I did inquire for?
It is no boast being asked to, say we are.
Orlando doth commend him to you both, and to that youth he calls his Rosalind, he sends his bloody napkin. Are you he?
I am. What must we understand by this?
Some of my shame, if you will know of me, what man I am, and how and why and where this handkerchief was stained.
I pray you tell it.
When last the young Orlando parted from you, he left a promise to return again. Within an hour, in pacing through the forest, chewing the food of sweet and bitter fancy, lo, it befell. Under an old oak, a wretched, ragged man, overgrown with hair, lay sleeping on his back. About his neck, a green and gilded snake had wreathed itself, who with her head, nimble in threats, approached the opening of his mouth. But suddenly, seeing Orlando, it unlinked itself, and, with indented glides, did slip away into a bush, under which bush a shade, a lioness, with udders all drawn dry, lay couching, head on ground with cat-like watch. This scene, Orlando did approach the man and found it was his brother, his elder brother.
Oh, I've heard him speak of that same brother, and he did render him the most unnatural that lived amongst men.
And well, he might so do, for all I know, he was unnatural.
But to Orlando, did he leave him there food to the stuffed and hungry lioness?
Twice did he turn his back, and purpose so, but kindness nobler ever than revenge, and nature stronger than his just occasion, made him give battle to the lioness, who quickly fell before him. In which hurtling, from miserable slumber, I awaked.
Are you his brother? Was you he rescued?
Was it you that did so oft contrive to kill him?
'Twas I, but 'tis not I. I do not shame to tell you what I was, since my conversion so sweetly tastes, being the thing I am.
But for the bloody napkin?
By and by. When from the first to last betwixt us two, tears our countenance most kindly bathed as how I came into that desert place. In brief, he led me to the gentle duke, who gave me fresh array and entertainment, committing me unto my brother's love, who led me instantly unto his cave. There, stripped himself, and here, upon his arm, the lioness had torn some flesh away, which all this while had bled, and now he fainted, and cried in fainting upon Rosalind. Brief, I recovered him, bound up his wound, and after some small space, being strong at heart, he sent me hither, stranger as I am, to tell the story that you may excuse his broken promise, and to give this napkin, dyed in his blood, unto the shepherd youth that he in sport doth call his Rosalind.
Why, how now, Ganymede? Sweet Ganymede!
Many will swoon when they do look on blood.
There's more in it. Cousin Ganymede!
Look, he recovers.
Would I were at home. We'll lead you thither. I pray you, take him by the arm.
Good cheer, youth. You a man? You like a man's heart.
I do so, I confess it. Ah, sirrah, a body would think this well counterfeited. I pray, tell your brother how well I counterfeit.
This is not counterfeit. There is too great testimony in your complexion that it was a passion of earnest.
Counterfeit, I assure you.
Well then, take a good heart and counterfeit to be a man.
So I do, but a faith. I should have been a woman by right.
Come, you look paler and paler. I pray you draw homewards.
A good sir, go with us.
Oh. that will I, for I must bear answer back how you excuse my brother, Rosalind.
I shall devise something, but I pray you commend my counterfeiting.
Will you go?
We shall find a time, Audrey. Patience, gentle Audrey.
Faith, the good priest was good enough for all the old gentlemen saying.
Oh, most wicked Lady Olive, Audrey, a most vile Martex. But, Audrey, there's a youth here in the forest lays claim to you.
Aye, I know who 'tis. He hath no interest in me in the world. Here comes the man you mean.
It is meat and drink to me to see a clown.
Good evening, Audrey.
God give good evening, William.
And good evening to you, sir.
Good evening, gentle friend. Cover thy head, nay, prithee, be covered. How old are you, friend?
25, sir.
A ripe age. Is thy name William?
Aye, sir. Aye, thank God.
Thank God, a good answer. Art rich?
Faith, sir. So-so.
So-so is good. Very good, very excellent good. And yet it is not, it is but so-so. Art thou wise?
Aye, sir. I have a pretty wit. Ah,
why, thou sayest well. I do now remember a saying. The fool doth think he is wise, but the wise man knows himself to be a fool. You do love this maid?
I do, sir.
Oh. Give me your hand. Art thou learned?
No, sir.
Then learn this of me. To have is to have, for it is a figure in rhetoric that drink, being poured out of a cup into a glass, by filling the one, doth empty the other. For all your writers do consent that ipsa is he. Now, you are not ipsa, for I am he.
Which he, sir?
He, sir, that must marry this woman. Therefore, you clown, abandon, which is in the vulgar, he, the society, which in the bourgeois is company, of this female, which in the common is woman, which together is, abandon the society of this female or clown, thou perishest, or to thy better understanding, dieth, or to which I kill thee, make thee away, translate thy life into death, thy liberty into bondage, I will kill thee 150 ways, therefore tremble and depart.
Do, good William.
God rest you merry, sir.
Could it be that on so little acquaintance you should like her? That but seeing you should love her, and loving woo, and wooing she should grant? And shall you persever her to enjoy her?
Neither call the giddiness of it in question, the poverty of her, the small acquaintance, my sudden wooing, nor her sudden consenting, but say with me, I love Aliena. And say with her that she loves me, consent with both that we may enjoy each other. It shall be to your good, for my father's house and all the revenue that was old Sir Roland's will I estate upon you, and here live and die a shepherd.
You have my consent. Let your wedding be tomorrow. Thither will I invite the Duke and all his contented followers. Now, go you and prepare Aliena, for look you, here comes my Rosalind.
God save you, brother.
And you, fair sister.
My dear Orlando, how it grieves me to see thee wear thy arm in a scarf.
It is my arm, yes.
I thought thy heart had been wounded by the claws of the lion.
Wounded it is, with the eyes of a lady.
Did your brother tell you how I counterfeited to swoon when he showed me your handkerchief?
Aye, and greater wonders than that.
Oh, I know, for your brother and my sister no sooner met but they looked, no sooner looked but they loved, no sooner loved but they sighed, no sooner sighed but they asked one another the reason, no sooner knew the reason but they sought the remedy. And in these degrees they have made a pair of stairs to marriage, which they will climb incontinent, or else be incontinent before marriage. They are in the very wraths of love. Clubs cannot part them.
They will be married tomorrow, and I will bid the Duke to the nuptial, but how bitter a thing it is to look into happiness through another man's eyes. By so much the more shall I tomorrow be at the height of heart heaviness, by how much I shall think my brother happy in having what he wants.
Why then, tomorrow I cannot serve your turn for Rosalind.
Live no longer by thinking.
I will weary you no longer than with idle talking. Know of me then, for now I speak to some purpose. That I know you are a gentleman of good conceit. Believe then, if you please, that I can do strange things. And if you do love Rosalind so near your heart as your gesture cries out, tomorrow when your brother marries Aliena, you shall marry her. For I know into what straits of fortune she is driven, and it is not impossible to me, if it appear not inconvenient to you, to set her before you tomorrow, human as she is and without danger.
Speakest thou in sober meaning?
By my life, I do. Therefore, put you in your best array, bid your friends. For tomorrow, if you will be married, you shall. And to Rosalind, if you will. Look who comes here, a lover of mine and a lover of hers.
Woof! You have done me much injustice to show the letter that I writ to you.
I care not if I have. It is my study to seem despiteful and ungentle to you. You are followed by a faithful shepherd. Look upon him, love him, he worships you.
Good shepherd, tell this youth what 'tis to love!
It is to be all made of sighs and tears, and so am I for Phoebe.
And I for Ganymede.
And I for Rosalind.
And I for no woman.
It is to be all made of faith and service, and so am I for Phoebe.
And I for Ganymede.
And I for Rosalind.
And I for no woman.
It is to be all made of fantasy, all made of passion, and all made of wishes, all adoration, duty, and observance, all humbleness, all patience and impatience, all purity, all trial, all observance. And so am I for Phoebe.
And I for Rosalind.
And I for Ganymede. And so am I for no woman.
If this be so, why blame you me to love you?
If this be so, why blame you me to love you?
If this be so, why blame you me to love you? Why do you speak to, why blame you me to love you?
To her that is not here, nor doth not hear.
I pray you, enough of this. Tis like the howling of Irish wolves against the moon. Help you if I can. I would love you if I could. Tomorrow meet me altogether. I shall marry you if ever I marry a woman, and I will be married tomorrow. I will satisfy you if ever I satisfy a man, and you shall be married tomorrow. I will content you if what pleases you contents you, and you shall be married tomorrow. As you love Rosalind meet, as you love Phoebe meet, and as I love no woman, I'll meet. Fare you well, I have given you your commands.
I'll not fail if I live.
Nor I.
Nor I. Sometimes do not, as those that fear they hope and know they fear.
Patience once more whilst our compact is urged. You say, if I bring in your Rosalind, you will bestow her on Orlando.
That would I, had I kingdoms to give her.
You say you will have her if I bring her.
That would I, were I of all kingdoms king.
You say you will marry me if I be willing.
That will I, should I die the hour after.
But if you do refuse me, you shall then wed this most faithful shepherd.
So is the bargain.
You say you will have Phoebe if she be willing.
Though to have her and death were both one thing.
To make these matters all even, keep you your word, Duke, to give your daughter. You yours, Orlando, to receive his daughter.
keep your word, Phoebe, that you'll marry me, or else refusing me, that you'll then wed this shepherd. Keep your word, Silvius, that you will have Phoebe if she be willing. And from hence I go, to make these doubts all even.
I do remember in this shepherd boy some lively touches of my daughter's favor.
My lord, the first time that ever I saw him, me thought he was a brother to your daughter. But, my good lord, this boy is forest born and hath been tutored in the rudiments of many desperate studies by his uncle.
There is sure another flood tour, and these couples are coming toward the ark. Here comes a pair of very strange beasts, which in all tongues are called fools.
Salutation and greeting to you all.
Good, my lord. Bid him welcome. This is the motley-minded gentleman I have so often met in the forest. He hath been a courtier, he swears.
If any man doubt that, let him put me to my purgation. I have tried measure, I have flattered a lady. I have been politic with my friend, smooth with mine enemy. I have undone three tailors. I have had four quarrels, and like to have fought one.
Good, my lord, like this fellow.
I like him very well.
God ills you, sir, I desire you of the like. I press in here, sir, amongst the rest of the country copulatives, to swear and to forswear according as marriage binds and blood breaks. A poor virgin, sir, an ill-favored thing, sir, but mine own. A poor humor of mine, sir, to take that no man else will. Rich honest who dwells like a miser, sir, in a poor house, as your pearl and your foul oyster.
By my faith, he is very swift and sententious.
According to the fool's bolt, sir, such dulcet diseases.
Then is there words in heaven when earthly things may even atone together? Good Duke, receive thy daughter. Highly from heaven brought her, yea, brought her hither, that thou might join her hand with his, whose heart within his bosom is. To you I give myself, for I am yours.
If there be truth in sight, you are my daughter.
To you I give myself, for I am yours.
If there be truth in sight, you are my Rosalind.
Sight and shape be true, why then my love adieu.
Yes.
I'll have no father if you be naughty. I'll have no husband if you be naughty. Nor ne'er wed a woman if you be not she.
Peace, ho, I bar confusion. 'Tis I must make conclusion of these most strange events. Here's eight that must join hands to join in Hymen's bands if truth holds true contents. You and you no are heart and heart. You and you no cross shall part. You to his love must accord, or have a woman to your lord. You and you are sure together as the winter to foul weather.
Aww.
While to wedlock can we sing, feed yourselves with questioning that reason wonder may diminish how thus we met and these things finish.
Which were on foot in his own conduct purposely to take his brother here and put him to the sword. And to the skirts of this wild wood he came, where, meeting with an old religious man after some question with him, was converted. Both from his enterprise and from the world, his crown bequeathing to his banished brother, and all their lands restored to them again that were with him exiled.
In this forest, let us do those ends, that here were well begun and well begot, and after every of this happy number, that have endured shrewd days and nights with us, shall share in the good of our returned fortune, according to the measure of their states. Meantime, forget this new fallen dignity, and fall in our rustic revelry. Play, music, and you brides and bridegrooms all, with measure heaped in joy, to the measure's fall.
Lady, by your patience. If I had heard you rightly, the Duke had outrageous life and thrown into neglect the pompous court?
He hath!
To him will I. Out of these comfort heights, there is much matter to be heard and learned. You to your former honor I bequeath. Your patience and your virtue well deserves it. You to a love that your true faith doth merit. You to your land, your love, and your great allies. You to a long and well-deserved bed. And you to Wrangley, for thy loving voyage is but for 2 months' victual. So, to your pleasures. I am for other than for dancing measures.
Stay, Jake, please. Stay.
To see no pastime, I. What you would have, I'll stay to know at your abandoned cave.
Proceed. Proceed. We'll begin these rites, and we do trust they'll end in true delights.
Bid me farewell.